Electric has come up with what's called a power supply improvement plan. And so we, as a public service at Maui Tomorrow, we have asked if they would want to have the public come and be able to ask questions and learn more about the plan. So I would like to introduce some of our board members. This is Doug McLeod, and he is the vice president of Maui Tomorrow. And then we have Maury King, somewhere in the aisle. Okay, that's Maury, he's on our board. And we also have our advisory board, Mr. Dick Mayer. Is there anybody else here from the Maui Tomorrow board? Okay, and outside at our desk is our research assistant, Kalei Hendershot. So anyway, welcome everybody. I'd just like to say before we get started that this is a plan that was put together, and I believe it's the third power supply improvement plan. What is it?
It's an update to the...
It's an update, okay. Anyway, there were a couple of plans that were put together more recently that actually, in my understanding, did not go 100% renewable, but this is doing that. We can have different opinions about how we get there, but it's a really good thing that Maui Electric is pushing a plan now, floating a plan, I should say, to have 100% renewable energy in electricity production on Maui. So, let's give it up for Maui Electric. And with that, I'd like to have Sharon Suzuki come up. Sharon is the president of Maui Electric, and she's going to introduce some of the people from Meco who are here tonight.
Thank you very much, Albert, and good evening. Welcome, and thank you for joining us tonight. I think this is a really important topic for our future and your future in terms of how we deliver electricity and provide you service. So we're really proud to be co-hosting this event with Maui Tomorrow. So I was telling some of the members out there in the lobby, I think we've really made a lot of progress in terms of coming together and collaborating with Maui Tomorrow to host something like this. So it's really an honor to be here tonight. As Albert said, we did recently file, we think, very aggressive plans to get Maui County to 100% renewable energy. There's a renewable portfolio standard that requires us to get there by 2045. But you'll hear from my team that we're actually targeting getting Molokai to 100% by 2020, Lanai by 2030, and hopefully Maui by even 2040. So it's going to be, it's going to take a lot of work. The challenge is balancing getting to that 100% renewable goal while maintaining reliable service to all of you, as well as then keeping the pricing affordable. So it's kind of a balancing act, you know. So as technology changes and everything, you know, we want to be ready to make the best decisions we can without committing us to long-term high prices, okay, while still transitioning and transforming. I'd like to, at this time, introduce some of the panelists for Maui Electric. So first we have Todd Kanja, who's the General Manager of System Planning at Hawaiian Electric. So we get a lot of support from his team in terms of doing a lot of the analysis and helping to prepare the filings to the PUC. We have our Manager of Customer Solutions and Planning, Ellen Nashiwa. Ellen. Our Manager of Power Supply at Maui Electric, Matt McNeff. And our Director of Planning, responsible for coordinating our input into the Power Supply Improvement Plan with Todd's group, Mike Ito. Mike. So I'd like to share a little bit of background on Maui Electric. Who are we? Well, we serve, I mentioned Maui, Molokai, and Lanai, and we serve about 70,000 customers. About 65,000 of those are in Maui. 1,700, 2,000 roughly on Lanai, and about 3,000 on Molokai. And many of you who have been here and may have traveled to those islands know that each island is really unique. We also are very committed to working in the community. So a lot of our work, we've been reaching out to the different islands and meeting with in smaller groups to get information on the thoughts and values of the different communities on energy. And we will continue to do that, especially with the recent filing. This is not a plan that's set in stone, so we certainly want input, we want your ideas. And thank you for those of you who've provided questions in advance so we can prepare and address them at the end of our presentation. You know that we really are here, our team of about 350 employees, that's across the three islands. Works really hard every day, and they're very adaptable to the changes that we need to make. So I think that's one of the nice things about being the smaller utility serving three smaller islands compared to maybe a larger scale Oahu with a huge population. We have more connections and we're very involved in the community, not just in our everyday work, but also in terms of corporate giving. We support a lot of science, technology, engineering, and math programs because it's important for our future, the development of future leaders that we hope will return home to Maui and be the leaders of in the energy industry. We're also working to restructure ourselves internally to better serve you so that we can leverage the economies of scale and the purchasing power of our three utilities. We're part of the Hawaiian Electric family of companies, so serving Oahu, Maui County, and Hawaii County. So to the extent that we can align our processes and procedures and find efficiencies, we think that we can get to 100%, move quicker, and hopefully keep our fixed costs to serve down. Last year, we were looking at the potential of a merger with NextEra. The Public Utilities Commission did not approve that, but we're very fortunate to have the support of Hawaiian Electric Industries. It's the holding company that owns Hawaiian Electric Company and American Savings Bank. And we're both local companies and locally managed. And they have assured us that they can help fund our future to get to 100% renewable energy. So we don't need to merge with another company, and we're not for sale. But it's really gonna take this type of forum, partnering with organizations like Maui Tomorrow, other environmental groups, the community, government, policymakers, businesses, and developers, to get us to this goal. We can't do it alone. So we certainly look forward to hearing from you and working with other partners to reach our very ambitious goal. So with that, I'd like to turn the program over to Todd, who will share more about our power supply improvement plan process.
Hey, good evening. Thank you all for taking the time and spending your time, your evening with us to learn a little bit more about our plans. Actually, it's really the community's plans as well, because it does affect each and all of us. In addition to the traditional metrics of safety and reliability, we have actually, in the PSIP, we talk about seven renewable energy planning principles. And rather than listing that long list, we've simplified it here in how we think about it. So in addition to providing electricity in a safe and reliable way, as well as it being very cost-effective and economical and now clean with 100% renewable energy goal, we need to be very smart about it. And we're gonna be talking about sort of how all these factors put together. So in terms of reliability, we still have the basic need to, or basic service of providing energy so that the lights stay on and that we provide reliable service. But as you're going to see, and as our plans come together, we do actually have a fairly old system, and we're going to need to modernize that system to make everything work, both distributed as well as grid scale resources. I used to actually, prior to working at Hawaiian Electric, I spent 7 years at Queens Medical Center. It's the director of facilities, and I understand what the need for reliable energy, because when the lights go out at the hospital, everything really stops. And it's just, it's a really scary moment. And yeah, so, you know, having that background in the hospital, it's something that I never take for granted, having reliable energy. And it's something that, as we do our planning, we understand the importance of being able to keep the lights on for our customers and what it means to everybody. Along the same lines, we always need to ensure that we provide our service in an economical way. So as we transform our system from the traditional fossil type generation to something that is state of the art and clean energy, we need to do it in a way that's also cost effective and affordable for our customers, and something that's really going to control our rates going forward and not be subject to the volatility of fossil fuels. Clean, I think we get it. We're headed towards a clean energy future. We want to get to 100%, as Sharon said, Molokai 2020, Lanai by 2030, and Maui by 2040. If there's opportunities to do it, you know, we're trying to do it as fast as we can, but we think we've set fairly aggressive, but at the same time, realistic goals. And we want to start with some of the smaller islands so that we can learn. We're not going to say that we can do everything at one time, because everything that we do, we're kind of leading edge. So we have states coming to our planning departments all the time to understand. California, in fact, we just had a meeting with a lot of the Southern Cal Edison, San Diego Gas and Electric, Pacific Gas and PGE come down to us to understand what we're doing with distributed generation so that they can learn from what we've been doing as well as share their ideas as they go forward. Smart, we need to be very flexible. And actually this concept, actually I'm going to give credit to Maui, as part of the earlier PSIP process, the April PSIP we did earlier this year, one of the feedback we got was that a feeling that the plans weren't flexible enough to embrace emerging technologies. And one thing that we learned from that, we listened, like, yeah, how do you set a 30-year plan but build in flexibility to that? So what we did for this particular PSIP was we focused on the next 5 years and said, hey, we need to take it in smaller bite-sized pieces, but ensure that any move that we make doesn't prevent our ability to be able to adjust our plans and embrace this new technology, maybe cheaper, maybe better. And that's certainly what we've seen over the last few years. We want to be able to take advantage of that. So, you know, that particular bullet item, you know, a lot of it comes back to feedback that we got from Maui, actually. Thank you for providing us with that input. And it's something, it's a planning principle that we've embraced in our plans, and hopefully we will be able to share our thoughts about that as we go forward. We mentioned transformation. People talk about transformation and how we are changing our systems. So we have two columns there. One that sort of describes the things that we've done kind of in the past up to today, and looking forward, going into the future, how we have to change our approach. You know, up to today, we've had renewable energy for select customers. But really, looking forward, we need to have renewable energy for all customers, and we need to provide our customers with choice. And, you know, we'll be talking about some of the other programs, not only in rooftop PV, but demand response programs as well, that our customers will be able to participate in and actually contribute and provide valuable services to help make everything work. We've had traditional procurement, you know, basically very sort of rigid, define sort of the resources and really define it in a box, which makes it less flexible. And, you know, I think we want to change that procurement. In this particular PSIP, we explained that as we go out for procuring these resources, that we want to keep the door open to all resources. So we're technology agnostic. Even though the computer modeling picked, for example, wind, we're open to solar and batteries, or it could be biofuel, you know, redeveloping some land to provide biofuel, whatever it may be. We're interested in looking and understanding what all available technologies are and to be able to bid into that process so that we can try to provide the best possible and lowest cost for the benefit of our customers. Also for RPS milestone planning, previously when we looked at our PSIP, we sort of looked at it as a 30-year plan. We had all these, trying to hit all of these targets. But like we mentioned on the prior slide, it kind of set up plans that looked and actually felt very, very inflexible. And we felt, well, how do you modify those plans as technology and costs change? We want to be able to adjust our plans as costs and technology change over time. And flexibility is really, really important part of that. So whatever we do, we want to ensure that we do not crowd out future renewable technologies that may be better and more cost effective as time goes on. Today, we rely on fossil fuel. And what we need to do is basically eliminate fossil fuel as we go forward. And we want to do it as quickly as possible. We talked about providing our customers with the best possible value, as well as stability in prices. And as we complete that transition, we think it's going to be a positive thing for our customers. Transportation is a big one. We are certainly aware of it. The ball is rolling in energy, but not much has been done in the way of transportation. And as opposed to transportation planning in a silo, which it's sort of been up to date, we know that the ball is rolling on what we're doing here, that, you know, we need integrated planning for transportation as well as electricity will be beneficial if you do it earlier rather than later. And it's certainly better doing it collaboratively as opposed to doing it in siloed efforts. So in the future, we believe that integrated planning is going to be very, very important as we go forward. Today, episodic planning, very reactionary. PUC issues the order. Todd here, my hair would stand up and say, oh no, we got a new deadline. But really what we need to do to be flexible is to have continuous planning. We need to be doing it continuously. We need to be continually understanding what's available as prices are changing. Energy storage is is something that we need to pay close attention to. And we need to stay on top of it and really have our finger on the pulse and be able to react very quickly as conditions change and technology may change. So, you know, we talked about sort of the principles that we apply to developing the PSIP, sort of how we're transforming the way we do business. And sort of what that has resulted in is action plans. And these are the key bullet items actually from the executive summary. I'm sorry, it's a lot of words, but these are some of the key takeaways if you don't want to read all 2,000 pages. So this is a pretty good summary. So what we're striving to do is our 2020 RPS mandate is actually 30%. So if we actually execute our PSIP and we execute it well and be able to achieve everything that we've laid out there, in 2020 we hit an RPS actually of 48%. And the planning period goes actually to 2021. Sorry, we're 1 year beyond. It goes to 52%. Sharon mentioned taking Molokai to 100% renewable energy by 2020. And that will, I'm sure we will learn a lot going through that process. But we're gonna have to move very quickly, and we're gonna have to move and put a lot of energy into making that happen. We also want to maximize distributed energy resources, fairly compensated. We've certainly heard and seen the interest that our customers have in participating in these initiatives, and we feel that desire for customers to participate will continue. It's just that we've actually hit limitations within our grid, which needs to be modernized. And we need to look at those kind of improvements that are gonna provide the customers choice as we move forward. We want to also, along that same line, take advantage of demand response programs. So instead of building new generators or building new resources, we ask the customers to actually alter their behavior so that we actually change when people are using energy. So as opposed to creating a giant peak where you need to use resources for such a short period of time or create more energy storage than perhaps was necessary, what we did in this particular plan is maximize our anticipation of how people are actually going to participate and change their behaviors to basically alter when they're going to be using energy, from example, between the 5 to 7 o'clock peak hours when they all come home, to being able to spread that out when the resources are more readily available. So demand response is going to be an important part of the plans as we go forward. One of the other things too, that given what's going on in the political world at the federal level, is really the need to aggressively seek grid scale renewable resources and leveraging the federal tax credits that are available today. One can only guess what's going to happen in the future. But for sure, what we know is the tax law as it exists today, and those federal tax credits are declining, and in the case of wind, will actually sunset at the end of 2019. So we do have a very limited window to try to take advantage of these tax credits that will only benefit Hawaii, right? So we have the whole nation sort of paying into this, and we can certainly benefit by taking advantage of those tax credits, and we certainly want to do that. I mentioned grid modernization several times, that we do need to pursue grid modernization to continue the integration of renewable energy, not only on a grid scale, but also at the customer level, to incorporate more DGPV, to develop programs that we can maximize customer participation in our demand response programs. We're going to need to have a much more modern grid than the traditional type of system that we have today, where there's very, I'm going to call it low tech, but you know, it's what we have. We also want to, you know, I've talked about flexibility many times, and I can't stress that enough. We want to preserve long-term flexibility, really to take advantage of emerging technologies. You know, if we were to roll the clock 5 years back and sort of envision what's going on today, I think maybe some people could have predicted it, but I don't know that everybody could have predicted everything the way that things have turned out today and what we're seeing in terms of renewable energies being so price competitive. And there's gonna be new technology breakthroughs going forward. So we want to be able to take advantage of them and retain the flexibility to be able to incorporate those technologies. And as prices do change over time, we wanna be able to take advantage of it. Circumstances also may change, and we want to be able to have the flexibility to adjust our plans to adjust accordingly. Finally, we want to reduce our operations that use fossil fuels. You know, on the prior slide, today's operations, we do use fossil fuels. Going forward, we want to eliminate the use of fossil fuels and its impact to really the environment and reduce our impact on global warming. So really from a high level, if you take a look at really the executive summary of our PSIP, that's sort of what we're trying to, that's what was discussed. So I sort of covered in three slides what was I'll save the introduction as well. So I'll save you reading 30 pages. So, but Ellen was gonna come up and provide more details, some of the more details and some of the RPS breakdown, how it looks over time. Specific about the resource plans that planned out for Maui, Molokai, as well as Lanai. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Ellen. Thank you.
Thank you, Todd. So utilizing the principles that Todd just outlined, we developed plans for Maui, Molokai, and Lanai, which effectively aim to balance integrating more renewable energy with reliability and cost. The plans are just starting points that describe a possible path forward over the long term to meet the state's 100% renewable energy goals by 2045 or earlier. But planning is a continual process, as you've heard, that adjusts over time to account for changes in policy, technological breakthroughs and advancements, regulatory environmental requirements, and other changes. The farther ahead you plan, the more the uncertainties increase. For this reason, we've emphasized the near-term actions that will put us on the path forward to 100% renewable energy. We continue to encourage energy efficiency first so we can continue to enjoy our lifestyle at lower costs. We expect customers' interest in solar and storage to continue and have assumed a high rooftop solar adoption rate and a storage component that's fairly compensated for the benefit of all customers. We plan to utilize customer-sided resources to provide grid services and compensate customers for this service through what Todd mentioned, your demand response programs. So really a combination of distributed and utility resources to meet energy needs. We intend to aggressively pursue renewable energy projects by 2020 to take advantage of the dwindling tax credits and modernizing our grid to enable the integration of these distributed and large-scale resources. This is the Renewable Portfolio Action Plan over the 5-year period, which we get from 46% to 63% for Maui Electric, utilizing or relying on customer-sized solar, as well as grid-sized solar and wind. For Lana'i, the principles and the concepts are the same. We continue to encourage energy efficiency. Customer-sized projects will continue. We will urgently seek to incorporate renewable resources by 2020, which take advantage of the tax credits, and focus on modernizing the grid to accept these renewable energy resources. The Lana'i's plans to right now are show an RPS of 59% by 2020. And finally, Molokai. So similar to the other islands, the concepts are the same, and the resources include customer-sized projects, renewable energy by 2020 to take advantage of the tax credits and grid modernization. However, Molokai, as you've heard, we are striving to attain 100% renewable energy on Molokai earlier by 2020. Then Molokai is already experiencing some system challenges with the high penetration of solar already interconnected. The aggressive efforts to achieve 100% renewable energy on Molokai seek to identify possible solutions that can be to system challenges that can be applied to other islands and other systems, but at a lower cost. So talking in more detail about the efforts to get Molokai to 100% renewable, we'll be focusing on engaging with the community. The community is a big part of our plans, and to really engage with them and learn from and get feedback, gaining their input on future resources and future plans, finding solutions on the utility side to accommodate these new resources, developing solutions for customers and options to reduce their bills, as well as exploring options to fund these investments and solutions beyond the traditional utility cost structure, seeking external funding assistance to help support these investments in these changes. So the next steps are to focus on executing on the near-term action plan, maximizing the distributed resources and the demand response resources, and partnering with our customers to incorporate more renewable energy. We also issued a land request for information that will help to facilitate the integration and the development of renewable resources. And upon commission approval, issue requests for proposals for firm and as available resources. Develop a grid modernization strategy, continuously review these long-term plans and review rate design to ensure the optimum use and integration of distributed resources. And with focus on equity for all, as well as continue the stakeholder and community discussions like tonight to get feedback, because working together, we will achieve these near-term action plans. Okay. Now I'll turn it over to Matt. You know, with this as a proposed path forward for our islands, Matt will be sharing our progress and steps that we've already been taking to continue our momentum and achieve 100% renewable energy.
Thanks, Ellen. So our renewable plans did not start with this version or previous versions of the power supply improvement plan. We've been working at this for some time. And in that time, we've been able to reduce the number of generators that we have running all the time, lower the output of the generators that are on, and increase automation and flexibility of our existing generation fleet, all of which help to accept additional renewable energy and lessen our use of fossil fuels. We've also looked into novel ways that others can help perform critical grid services instead of us, if by doing so, we are allowing more renewable energy onto the system. And last but not least, it's already been a decade ago that we tested all our generators at the Ma'alaya facility for running on biodiesel. That's not to say that everything went as planned. In theory, we have a lot of additional tools that can help us getting to our and the state's goals. And we have been working on using all of these tools, such as time of use rates to help out when the energy, to help even out the energy throughout the day, demand response to help when the demand is the highest, and storage to help store some of this renewable energy when it's made but not necessarily needed. But in practice, it's hard to implement all of these tools and get it right the first time, especially when conditions are changing so quickly. This is what the energy use throughout the day looked like on January 30th, 2017. The blue line represents the electrical usage that Maui Electric had to serve. Notice that the energy usage is now lower during the day than it is during the night when most people are sleeping. And that's one of the major changes that's just occurred over the recent past few years. The load at the low point during the day is about 75 megawatts, and as far as I know, that's the lowest we've ever seen it during the day. The red line is the estimated solar production for the day that I added back in, just to give you an idea of what Maui Electric would have had to serve if January 30th was a cloudy day. You can see there's a considerable difference between the two, and the system operator, or the guy trying to decide what generators to turn on or turn off, is seeing this all unfold in real time. If you look at where the red line and the blue lines intersect right around 8 or 9 a.m., you can see that the difference between those two scenarios is whether we should turn on additional generation or we should actually start turning off generation. So if there's this much difference in just one day, you can imagine that the difference over weeks, months, and years that we're trying to, you know, adapt to. This is our Kanaha substation. It's on the corner of Derry Road and Hana Highway. It is the site of the very first battery project that I worked on back in 2011. We had received a grant for the project to install a flow battery to help with renewable integration. Can anyone see the battery in the photo? Probably not, because it never arrived. The manufacturer could not produce the battery we had contracted for, or any battery that could meet the requirements of the grant, and the project fell through. Since then, we've had numerous experiences with batteries that did get installed, but could not meet the requirements they were installed to meet, and battery manufacturers that have gone bankrupt or changed ownership and no longer support their products. We've also evaluated other storage technologies like pump storage hydro numerous times in the past. But so far, we've not been able to find a way to implement those storage technologies that did not increase costs to our customers, and in some cases actually increase our fossil fuel use. Batteries and other storage technologies have a lot of potential, and we continue to evaluate them as costs decrease. But in practice, unlike theory, there is no silver bullet. You know, real life is complicated, and models, by necessity, rely on simplifications to reduce the number of variables that need to be evaluated, or to reduce the complexity of the variables that are evaluated. Models can help us make decisions and plan for a direction that, on average, would be the most beneficial to pursue. But as this gentleman in the depiction found out, the world does not operate on averages. So while models are useful, we cannot over-rely on them and their inherent simplifications. We need to maintain flexibility in operations to accommodate for off-normal conditions. I like to think of it as, modelers like to think of how we operate 90% of the time, and operators are concerned with how we operate the other 10%. Because we need to provide power to our customers, folks like you and me, you know, things when, at times when reasonably bad things occur, or in cases like now, where we're in uncharted territory with regards to changes in generation and electrical usage that we need to adapt to in real time. And while it's more complicated than the sound bites and the media clips suggest, we will adapt as we have been doing for the last 95 years. Thank you.
We announced a little earlier that if you have questions, we have these green question sheets that we'd like you to write out your question. And if you didn't get one, raise your hand. And I know that Lori folks, there we go. And they're going to get you those and go ahead and write your questions. We thought that this would give us the opportunity to get to as many questions as possible tonight. So they're going around and distributing it to them. So Doug McLeod and I'm Mahina Martin with Maui Electric, and you met Doug McLeod earlier, will help facilitate this portion and offer you as much time as possible to handle as many questions as we can. Where is Doug?
I'm up here. Okay. Let's make sure my, there we go, my mic's live. Anyway, we do have an initial set of questions that we're going to ask, and we got these from two different sources. So we did one set of questions that came from the Energy Committee within Maui Tomorrow. Then we have a set of questions that came from the broader community. We actually just sent out, you know, a general email request for questions. Where we want to start on our end tonight, really, you showed us a graph talking about a distinction between today and the future. And so our first question to you is, when is this new plan and this new approach really going to start? And specifically what we're talking about is, since the sugar company has gone out of business, the actual proposals from MECO have been to purchase new diesel generators. And so we're trying to understand, when we hear this vision for the future, it's wonderful. I mean, you've gone from, you know, talking about whether to have 100% renewable to how. But we're struggling with when this new approach starts, because what we're seeing is, with regard to these new diesel generators, we just can't mesh what we're hearing. So that's our first question, is when does this new approach and new plan start with regard to Maui?
Okay, we're gonna actually have two of us answer this. So I'm gonna answer the first part regarding the plan. And so planning starts now. However, it's going to take some time for us to actually work through the actual process. We can work through customers. In fact, we have a filing with demand response going in tomorrow. And we're going to try to continue what we can do in the way of integrating more DGPV, whether it be right now we have customer self-supply systems available. So we want to do it now, but for some of the other resources, it's going to take some time for us to implement this, and we want to move as quickly as possible. In fact, we filed letters to the commission asking to open dockets to start the RFP process for procurement. So we want to do it as fast as possible. However, there's some actual operational needs to which Matt can better explain about the immediate near term. That Matt can provide some insight into.
Sure. Can you guys hear me? All right. Thanks for the question. So, as you mentioned, you know, conditions changed significantly in 2016. HCNS had announced that they were going to go out of sugar production, and along with that, stop providing power to Maui Electric. So we had kind of a, you know, an urgent need to replace the generation that previously they provided. We always try to balance, as you heard, you know, reliability, cost effectiveness, and renewable. And the DG units, the three diesel units that we're proposing to install, were able to meet the timeline we needed. However, they weren't the only solution that we're pursuing as a result of HCNS, you know, stopping production. We also submitted a demand response program for expedited approval. We repurposed batteries at our Wailea substation. And in the end, you know, those diesel units are proposed for only temporary, only until such time that we can install permanent renewable generation, a process that we had started in the middle of last year. So as soon as we don't need those units, as soon as the need isn't there, as soon as renewable energy, permanent renewable energy is installed, we will get rid of them.
We'll go ahead on to the next question. One thing you didn't mention during your presentation, can you just confirm for the audience that your plans now do not involve any kind of inter-island cable, that your planning is for each island to achieve this on its own?
I'll take that one, Doug. Yes, our plans do not include an inter-island cable, as we were asked by the Public Utilities Commission to look at that scenario, but we've been meeting with folks on Maui, Molokai, and Nana'i, and have heard very loud and clear that that is not something that our communities here in Maui County support. So we understand that, and with the plan that was submitted by our three companies for the five islands that we serve, so I mentioned earlier, Oahu, Maui County, Maui, Molokai, Lanai, and Hawaii Island, served by Hawaii Electric Light Company, that the plans currently that were filed in December did not include a scenario with the inter-island cable, and that we can get to 100% without that project.
We're going to alternate between some of the pre-submitted questions from the public and Maui Tomorrow members and the audience as well. If you filled one out and you're ready for pickup, just raise it and our Minahuni will come and get it. All right, so this question says, speak a little more, a bit more, about coordinating transportation and electric planning. So I think it's electrification of transportation. Probably Ellen?
I'll take it. Ellen, you can add in whatever I don't cover, but electrification of transportation is something that our companies are committed to pursuing. We believe that there's a synergy between getting to 100% renewable and also facilitating cleaner transportation on the islands. And I think on Maui, many of you may know that we were a part of the demonstration project by Jump Smart Maui and the Hitachi Corporation that installed about 13 different electric vehicle charging stations. And it certainly helped to increase the adoption of electric vehicles on the island. So of course, getting to 100% and using the battery technology as well as in vehicles, in an aggregated way, could be part of the solution going forward. And to the extent that we can have rates that incent owners of electric vehicles to charge their vehicles if needed during the middle of the day when there's a lot of PV energy available, it would certainly help us to integrate more renewable energy. So again, we're looking at different ways to aggregate technologies or install new technologies or work in partnership with our customers to help us get to 100%. So that's one method that you know, we can partner with you going forward.
Do you want me to ask one? Right now, Maui has 72 megawatts of wind power. Your plan, if we understand it right, is calling for 62 megawatts of additional wind power on Maui Island. Where do you see those turbines being located?
So as Todd mentioned in his presentation, as far as the resources, we're very open to what developers are there to offer. So again, we've requested an opportunity to solicit for new renewable energy resources, and depending on what's available in the development market, you know, we'll definitely evaluate all the different options and keep it open so we can make the best decision for all of the customers.
From the audience. The question is, there's a cap on net energy metering now. Does Maui Electric have any plans to get this program back?
So would we
The commission closed the net energy metering program in, back in October 2015, and we do have solar programs available, though we do have a self-supply program that's available for solar customers, as well as what we call a standard interconnection agreement. So another solar program that's open for customers to install solar on their roofs. We are in discussions with the stakeholders through a PUC process to discuss what other types of solar programs could be made available. We are in that phase now that's starting through this year to discuss what is possible and what is fair to all customers, not only those who have solar on their roofs, but also other customers as well.
If I could just add to that to provide some background on what we actually contemplated in this PSIP, we did contemplate an expansion of something similar to the customer grid supply. It was very, very popular, even after the NEM program. You know, we found that it was very, the participation was very strong. So what we basically envisioned was a high penetration of distributed generation that would basically take all single family residential homes to basically net zero, as well as about 20 to 25% of commercial customers. So we included very high levels and we're contemplating high levels of penetration going forward. So, you know, we just want to add that clarification that we did contemplate continued interest and participation from our customers.
Great, thanks, Kyle.
We have a question here. It says, in the PSIP update, the near-term action plan says that renewable energy is the first option. What happens if using LNG becomes significantly cheaper? What type of decision-making process is going to be used to determine which route to go in a situation where there would appear to be a cost savings from a fossil fuel?
Yeah, I think I can answer that. Well, the PSIP, we did actually look at LNG, and it did find that LNG did save some money. And so we've actually studied LNG very closely, actually as part of the NextEra merger, which is now behind us, even went as far as filing an application for LNG. However, the situation is very different. LNG, as going through that process, is a very long-term commitment. It's a very substantial financial commitment. And in taking a look at this particular PSIP, again, with the NextEra merger behind us and in moving forward, we also felt that there was not all stakeholders were really keen on the idea of LNG as really the best path forward because of its substantial commitment. So for these reasons, LNG was not included in our near-term action plan.
From the audience, there's two parts to this question, and I'm smiling because you'll know shortly why. Does this plan integrate with Oahu needs? Obviously, we don't feel this way, but mathematically, Oahu is the only island that matters, but we don't want to be an energy colony. What's the story with fuel cells to produce hydrogen to store energy seasonally or ship to Oahu? I think this might be a Todd.
I can try to answer this. So, I actually, Sharon, for those of I probably met with you folks sometime before in different venues, and I certainly heard the concerns of the cable and from Maui Electric. So, believe it, that voice and that input, we heard loud and clear.
At Maui Electric, we say what we want to say,
that's
and
right.
They help us the best way they can.
Yeah, that, and I listen. So no, the company listens, and we're certainly concerned, you know, about the cable. So actually, the way that this action plan was set up, every island, and if you look in the PSIP, what we did was every island was designed to head in a direction where it would be self-sustaining, and that's what we contemplated for this period, and that's sort of the initial 5 years that's a stake that we put in the ground. In terms of like something like hydrogen, it's something that is on the radar. It did come up as a fuel. and a potential means where you could use excess renewable energy to produce hydrogen, store it, and then use it as fuel, either in fuel cells or transportation or what have you. So it's something that we actually have our finger on the pulse. It is a fairly new technology. Well, it's not a new technology, but the costs are very high at this point. So it's something that we have our eye on and we want to certainly be aware of. Other energy storage things, I'm going a little off topic, not the cable, but just sort of energy storage on the lines of hydrogen. Pump storage hydro is something that we're also interested in, and we got our pulse on that as well. So we're definitely interested in and know that we need energy storage is going to be a part of our future, and we certainly want to be flexible and be able to take advantage of the best available technology. But you know, for this particular PSIP, what we said about the cables, we'll continue to look at the economics, but the plans are not contemplating the cable.
We have a lot of questions, but let's try to follow up with what you said. So you talked about storage, and for people in the energy business in Hawaii, the news that came out of Kauai recently was a shocker for all of us, that they had a project where they were able to provide PV plus storage for approximately 11 cents a kilowatt hour. And so our question is, you know, if that is really available, that sort of pricing, isn't that really what your customers want? Don't they prefer solar plus storage over any of the other options?
Actually, we're surprised, but actually we're pleased to hear that. Actually, we want to hear lower prices, because what that does is it sets the benchmark lower. And going forward, what our hope is that we can basically take advantage of that, and that sets a nice bar for future projects to be competitive, because other projects will be compared against that. And anytime we do see a new low, it's certainly a good thing, I think, going forward. In terms of procurement, when we developed the PSIP, we were actually ordered by the commission to go through and let computer models actually select the resource based on a lowest cost resource basis. In this particular case, in the case of Maui, it did select wind. Maui has some amazing wind resources as well as solar resources. But to ensure that we get the best value for the customers, what we're doing a little different with this, again, with this plan going forward, is we're going to ensure that our RFPs are agnostic to technology. So even though it may have called out wind, that RFP will actually be open to the same technologies, for example, PV plus storage. But what we're interested in is getting the best possible value for our customers.
This question actually has your name on it, Matt. It's customer-level energy storage systems like Tesla's Powerwall hardware would completely resolve the issues the operators face and eliminate the duck curve. Why are customer-level energy storage systems not being promoted or at least considered at this time?
I think we have several pilot programs, one particularly on Molokai, where we are trying to experiment with customer-sided energy storage. And I believe as part of our demand response efforts, that's one venue that we're providing to customers where they can start to provide grid services through energy storage that they have located at their house. Anyway, that's part of our proposed programs going forward, and it was part of the PSIP planning process.
If I can add to that, you know, for the customer-sided batteries, we will have demand response programs that will specifically provides incentives to do just that, to basically shift loads around, whether it be through EVUs or for putting a battery to basically shift loads around. That's certainly an option, as well as the existing customer self-supply option that Ellen mentioned.
I had a question that I actually submitted. I'll admit it. But actually, I've spoken with Sharon about this before. I was wondering if there would be the ability for those customers that do have battery backup, if you have a system right now where you can control their water heater, if you have a high demand situation, you can take it offline, and I think you pay them like $3 a month. Mm-hmm. And so you get through the generation emergencies that way. I was wondering if you could do that with someone who has a whole house battery system. You could, you know, if you have a generation shortage, or it's not windy, it's a cloudy day, or a big generator goes offline, if you could somehow control their battery system and then give them credit for that as well. And if so, I'm wondering how much, what would be the capacity, what would be the potential capacity that you could serve that way?
Okay, the way I see that is that water heater load control program that you mentioned is active on Oahu with some controllability at the customer location, right? So to the extent that we can have that type of controllability to each of you or people who are willing to make those investments, I think that could be a participant in our demand response programs. Did you look at something specific?
So one of the things that, I'm not the DER docket person, but one of the programs that are being explored, and you know, I know the solar contractors are looking for different ways to provide customers with different customer choice. So one of the programs that they're looking is very similar to that, where they have a PV system with batteries and having programs that don't export during the day but have the ability to export in the evening when it's actually needed. So it's something that's actually being discussed at the commission today. And I'm not sure exactly where it is, but I know within the last couple of weeks there was some intense dialogue at the commission about this as a possibility. And coincidentally, a water heater program was I did the Energy Scout for Business, which is actually the same platform that the water heater worked, and that was the first project I did at Hawaiian Electric, so I kind of go way back.
That's good to hear, and you might not have any idea right now, but if you were able to do something like that, what do you think the potential capacity of that would be in terms of megawatts?
Yeah, we don't have a really good estimate of that at this point, but again, one of the things that we need to be able to do those kind of things when we talk about grid modernization is to be able to have the interface with the customer. You know, everybody kind of chuckled when we said we kind of have an old system, and we do. I'll admit the water heater program works on like a pager, but it was implemented. Actually, when we rolled it out 10 years ago, actually 11 years ago, we knew it was kind of like obsolete technology. But really, that's what the challenge was how do we interface and communicate with the customer? And how do we provide the customer interface so that they have information and feedback on whether what it is that they're doing, they're doing the proper adjustments so that they're maximizing the benefit that they can provide to the system. So it's a tough challenge that we just got ordered from the commission to develop a grid modernization strategy, and we're gonna be working through that process. But it's a struggle that the industry is dealing with, how to best interface with the customer, and how do we do it cost effectively.
All right, from the audience, after and on the way towards 100% renewability, how will the price for customers change?
So of course, it's gonna, transforming the existing system that you heard from Todd is, you know, I mean, needs to be modernized. We'll take investments. So initially, the price to customers will increase, but over the long term, what we see is as we get more renewable energy, say contracts that are predictable or with a predictable pricing, right, that will lower bills, and to the extent that that continues and we get to the 100%, because we don't procure or sign purchase power agreements with developers where the price is expected to increase customer bills. So over time, you'll see more stable bills, and your bills will be lower than if we would have stayed status quo only on fossil fuels, where we see the volatility, right? And of course, getting to renewable energy with local sources helps us to address the energy security concerns that, of course, we have as an island state.
Yeah, we have a follow-up question that's related. Talking specifically about Molokai, plans to have 100% renewable energy there early. Just looking at that, if the main source of the renewable energy is biofuel, isn't that going to have some of the same price volatility? And our specific question is, are you going to see any decrease in the Molokai bills once you hit that 100% renewable, which we're saying will happen a lot earlier in Molokai?
So similar to what Sharon mentioned about the investment needed for Molokai and to integrate the renewable energy and to purchase the renewable energy that the plans call for, will take some investment. So it will take, over time, the bills will flatten out. But as far as immediately right after we hit 100%, not immediately right after you hit 100%.
Let me add something too. I think what we're trying to do at Molokai is to use it as an example. As Ellen mentioned earlier, we're seeing that excess energy, the duck curve in the middle of the day, sooner than maybe, we see the shape, right, on all islands. But it's at a point on Molokai where if we just keep adding PV, it's gonna actually lessen the reliability to customers, which is why we currently have a pause. We're looking at new solutions like what Matt shared, battery on the customer side with controllability from our operating control room on the island. But the challenge to minimize that impact to Molokai customers, so we want to test new technologies to prove them out and use Molokai as a showcase. So what we're trying to do is work with different organizations to apply for grant funding. Ellen and her team actually applied for a small scale PV and battery combination through the US Department of Agriculture Rural Communities Division. Still awaiting, right, whether or not we got it. We have applied to that organization before to get solar water heating. We were successful many years ago to get a grant from that organization, but the second time we requested it, we were denied. So to the extent that maybe we work with nonprofits on Molokai that have access maybe beyond us to different types of funding, it'll help buy down the cost of the investments that we need to make without negatively impacting the bills for those customers. One example is we were fortunate to have Hawaii Natural Energy Institute, that's at the University of Hawaii, provide that battery that we could install on the grid. So we paid for the installation, they provided the battery. Of course, that way the cost was lower, right? But we're still working. It was not meant to be a load shifting battery. It was really to help with the operational needs on the island. Matt could tell you more about how it was intended to operate. But we're still working to get the controllability working such that the battery can respond quick enough to the needs of the grid. So these are the types of technologies that we'd like to install, test and prove out, or make adjustments before we adapt them on our larger islands.
That was a fairly complicated answer. I want to go back and just ask one simple question, because we're just trying to understand, if you fire your units with liquid fuel, aren't you going to always have this price volatility, this movement, whether it's a fossil fuel or a biofuel, in comparison with, say, a solar project or, like you say, a battery situation where all the cost is up front? So I think our folks are really just asking, are you ever going to have the stability if you keep running liquid fuel through your units?
I can answer that. Every time you have a price component like variable price fuel like that, and actually we spent a lot of time looking at the hedge value of renewable energy. Actually, we spent a lot of time talking to Ulupona Initiative about this. But you're absolutely right. Anytime you have something that's a variable price component, you'll be subject to price volatility. So in doing the analysis, the objective was to actually eliminate biofuel completely. So we actually started from that premise
and actually tried to achieve it, and we struggled to be able to do it, to be very honest. We used unlimited, we actually had no constraints in storage and tried to actually model it, but given the amount of energy that's actually needed for Molokai, it just ended up very, very costly. So one of the things that we do for Molokai, and actually Matt's responsible for operation, and I guess the modeler guy, so sorry, Matt. But I fully acknowledge that, you know, when you do the models, we're trying to predict weather patterns, we're trying to integrate solar, we're trying to integrate wind, and there's combinations that there's just impossible to predict as we go forward. So one of the things that we do need, and Sharon mentioned, is we need to understand when you actually put this much renewables together, how is the system actually going to work? This battery that we actually have from HNEI, is it going to do what we actually need it to do? The whole objective is really to eliminate any kind of fuel, liquid fuel that we can, and we certainly want to have that. But we fully recognize at the end of the day that there's going to be extended periods where you do have weather that's just not conducive to producing energy, whether it be wind or solar, or sometimes we get both that are not available, and sometimes we get days where we get a lot of it. But at the end of the day, we still need to provide service to our customers, and we're going to have to figure out how best to achieve that. So some of the modeling does have, we do have biofuels, but the objective is certainly to eliminate that to the extent that we possibly can.
Thank you. I'm going to combine these two questions from two different people. They're related. Why are we waiting until 2040? Why will it take 23 years? And once Maui is 100% dependent on renewable energy generation, what will happen to the existing fossil fuel and diesel operations infrastructure? So why until 2040? Why does it take 23 years? And what happens to all the existing operations and infrastructure?
Okay, I'm gonna try to explain this as simple as possible. But energy storage, we're contemplating, we do know some things, like we have good data points on, for example, pump storage hydro. We have other possible data points on, for example, like hydrogen, converting to hydrogen. The other thing that we do have a curve on, we don't know for sure exactly if the curve is gonna be right, is on battery storage. So there's different curves out there, and what we try to do is actually use published data points for forecasts for energy storage going forward, for example, like from Tesla. And we actually try to get developers to share what they could with us, but they kind of kicked us back to the publicly available information because of competitive reasons. But looking forward, why does it take 23 years? What happens is, actually with this, some of you had asked me, 60 megawatts of wind, really, that's a lot. It's gonna take us over the peak. And yes, it will, initially, but what we need to do is then capture the excess with storage. But today the cost is quite high. It's not really that cost effective to shift a little bit of energy. So what you do is you overbuild. But over time, as you continue that overbuild, you want to be able to capture that excess energy. And the price of storage, we are expecting it to come down over time. So as the price of storage comes down, you want to continue your overbuild so that you can actually capture the excess energy and then shift that energy to times when you actually need it. So you can't think of it as a single dimension. You need to factor things over time with moving data points. So that's some of the things that the model will do that my brain doesn't have the ability to do. So it'll do the math for us. You put in these curves, and it'll figure out the optimal points when to make those investments. We mentioned about the need to do continual planning to really have our finger on the pulse. So as technology changes and to be flexible, so if emerging technology comes about, or price, there are significant price shifts, we want to be able to take advantage of that. Or if you're like me, you buy what you thought was the latest phone, and then the next month they come out with a new phone, and you're like, so we want to always preserve that flexibility of being able to take advantage of breakthroughs as they happen. So you know, it's gonna take time, and that's, you know, what the computer modeling shows us. And if we could accurately predict the future, which we know that we can, for sure the solution may look a little bit different, but this is using the information that's available to us today.
Maybe if I could add to that a little bit, you know, I mean, with regards to going back a little bit to the previous question, you know, there's pros and cons to all the decisions we make. Nothing is purely good or purely bad. And so what's going to happen to the fossil fuel, you know, infrastructure, you know, the units, the generators, when we go 100% renewable? Well, you heard Todd say they tried as best they could to get off, you know, any kind of liquid fuels, and it's very expensive. And so, you know, in the end, as we proceed through these plans, the question might arise, okay, what's it gonna be? Should we allow some of the existing generation to run on biofuels, or should we spend a lot of money on additional storage to be able to capture it for these very rare events where it, you know, maybe isn't sunny for a week and there's no wind? And I think those are the kind of decisions that we're looking to seek your guys' input on as we go forward in this continual planning process. So.
We had a question about geothermal energy, and the way we're reading the plan, it assumes that down the road, you know, 20 years or so, you know, that there is a geothermal resource. And the question is there any actual new data or, you know, new information that indicates that geothermal is really available here on Maui in a size or a certain price range?
So I can take that. So the short answer is no, there's not any new information regarding geothermal that's driving its inclusion in some of our planning. Like we've been talking about, there's always gonna be different pros and cons to all the different resources. And right now the geothermal is the result of what the modeling chooses as the most cost-effective solution at that particular time to add the generation that's needed. And so again, this is kind of the theme, but you know, when the time comes to get the generation, it's going to be open. We're not specifically choosing geothermal or wind or solar. It's what's going to provide the needs for the grid at that time.
From the audience, you mentioned grid modernization many times, but what does this mean? Please elaborate.
I can answer that one. So grid modernization is actually something that we're going to be working on, and the commission has actually issued us an order to start by developing a strategy. So grid modernization, actually the commission provided the definition for it, and I don't have it in front of me, but really what we envision it to be is basically the modifications that we need to make to our transmission and distribution system to basically enable us to actually achieve 100% renewable energy. So it's going to require modifications on the transmission system to have the ability to actually integrate the resources that, whatever it may be, and again, we are technology agnostic, so whether it's wind, PV, or some other technology, to be able to interconnect that to the system. It also means that on the distribution level, to be able to incorporate and allow our customers the ability to participate, whether it be through increased levels of DGPE or demand response programs. But it's basically a very broad term that's used to be able to achieve all of these future types of resources and programs to basically achieve our clean energy future. So to put it simply, and if anybody is from the commission, I apologize if it conflicts with their definition, but I mean, you know, we're gonna, I mean, basically that's what we need to do. And we have limitations on what we can physically do today that we're gonna need to correct.
And while we're doing definitions, we had a question about time of use programs, and I know you've referenced them a couple times. I'm not sure if the audience understands what they are. And, you know, number one, could you explain generally what this is? And number two, the follow-up question is, is the existing program friendly or fair to working people in terms of the hours?
So right now we have a time of use program that it's a pilot program, that was approved by the commission, and it's up to 5,000 customers to participate, so we can get experience with these rate periods. So what the time of use program does is it incentivizes or it gives discounted rates for encouraging energy use during the times when there are right now it's during the day because there's abundant solar production. So it's incentivizing shifting energy use from other time periods to the 9 to 4 time period. And you know that's just a pilot rate to determine the effectiveness and the ability for participants or customers to participate in these programs, like you mentioned, for people who work during the day rather than at night. And we'll be evaluating this as we go along. The program was just approved last year, so we are beginning to implement and to enroll customers, and it requires some infrastructure, some meter change out, so we can get information about their different times that they use energy. We have about 160 participants right now in Maui County. So most of them are Maui, some are Lana'i, and a few on Molokai. So we will be getting some information from how they're able to change their usage to take advantage of these rates.
I don't have X-ray vision, so let me get you. From the audience, what if federal leadership decides to continue resourcing with fossil fuel reliance rather than renewable and more efficient resources?
We're still committed to working towards getting to 100% renewable energy. It's our law in Hawaii, and we're not stopping. We're not taking our feet off the pedal. So.
Mr. Customers like that.
And I guess the follow-up question for us that's related, your plan is to hit the target 5 years early. How did you select 5 years? Is that a cushion, or you know, why five rather than 10 or 7 or some other figure?
Yeah, so you know, basically we have a somewhat staged approach, starting from smaller, working to larger. But I think for us, we have we understand the challenges and potential changing circumstances that we're gonna encounter. So for us to try to plan everything in 2045, I think logistically wouldn't make sense if that's when we need to achieve 100%. And the reality is we think actually there's tremendous opportunities on the neighbor islands. I'm actually on Oahu. I'm jealous of the resources actually on the neighbor islands, that it is going to be cost effective and we can do this. So we do have, and we want to accelerate getting there to 100%. But we also recognize, again, what the models show and what operations will show, that there's going to be a learning curve that we need to go through. And again, trying to avoid putting all our eggs in one basket or making assumptions that are basically not the best assumptions in how we go about our planning. So I think we want to take a staged approach, learn from our experiences of Molokai, like Sharon had said, gain that operational experience, understand where our modeling needs to be modified so that we can better model it going forward, and then basically apply it going forward. But like Sharon said, we have our foot on the pedal. If there's opportunities, we're gonna continually plan, and we're looking for the best way to achieve the clean energy goals.
How do you reconcile your business model of a return on investment and shareholder concerns with achieving 100% renewable energy?
To some degree, first of all, we need to continue to give a fair return to our investors to get to the 100%, but we want to do it in a smart way, like Todd said earlier. I think what we want to do to the extent that we solicit for a new generation through the request for proposal process, when we enter into purchase power agreements, we don't make any money off of those contracts and the pricing that we negotiate. It gets passed through to our customers, so that's why we're looking for the lower cost. So we don't have an adder on that. So to the extent that that becomes a larger portion of our portfolio, it's actually fair to you folks in terms of your customer bills. So we're not looking to just put everything into our rate base. We're looking at different options, even in terms of ownership, that if maybe it makes better sense to have hybrid solutions where developers have come to us and said, hey, you know, we can do it all ourselves as a developer, or we can do joint ventures. And I think going forward, we need to be flexible and look at what could be the better option, where it's not all us, not all the developer, maybe a joint venture of some sort could make sense going forward. So I think those are the kind of new approaches we'd like to use moving forward, because we know that we can't stay the same and be successful.
And if I can just add to that, I was speaking to Chris earlier, he very astutely pointed out that this is going to require more than $20 billion worth of investment over the next 30 years. And that's certainly tremendous opportunity. And you know, for the company, we're actually looking for developers as well as customers to basically share in those investments. And we certainly, there's ample investments to be made. And we certainly need others to participate. So when we talk about it, you know, we all need to work collaboratively together. It's going to take more than the utility to be able to do that. So it's, you know, the amount of investment that we need to transform is substantial, but, you know, the rewards are certainly there for everybody.
Hi. I would just like to know, in terms of some of these proposals for solar farms and maybe wind farms and things, do you have any locations that you can share with us that were submitted as part of that RFI, the request for information? We know that there are some proposals for solar and or wind up above Kihei, but is there anything else that you can share with us?
I personally don't have that information. I don't know if anyone else on the panel has. We know that the, I think it closed at the end of January, I thought, or around that time frame. So we don't have that information available tonight.
At what point would you be able to share it?
I guess we'll have to look into that.
Okay.
Yeah. But we'll be happy to share what we can when we do get it.
We have committed to an hour and 15 minutes of questions with you. So we'll do our best. It's so amazing to have all this interest prior to tonight as well as tonight. I will tell you that if we do miss your question because of lack of time, we will be here. We're not running out the door. They are on flights tomorrow and late tonight. And if you still want your question answered, we did not ask for contact information. I encourage you to go to any of these easel pads here, write out your question with a contact information, make sure we can read it, your email and our phone number, and one of our staff will get back to you personally to try to give you that answer. So here's another question from the audience. Oh, hold on, the same one. Sorry about that. Okay. You have used the term fairly compensated several times. What does fairly compensated mean? I'm not sure, must have been part of some discussion. What is fairly compensated?
So fairly compensated, I think, is simply put so that we're not shifting costs from one class of customers to the other. So, you know, I think what we want to have is ensure that customers that are in a given situation aren't burdened, basically paying for more than their fair share of the actual infrastructure needed to service our customers.
And we just have one or two more questions actually from the Maui Tomorrow questions. And we can actually kind of lump two of them together here. And you mentioned clean energy. And so really the questions that we have are related. You know, first, is carbon reduction something that you are explicitly trying to build into your plan? And then second, here on Maui, you know, when we see the Kahului power plant, which you know, emits a lot more pollution for every hour of operation than some of the newer plants. Is that factoring into your analysis, having the increased emissions from that plant, in terms of how you think about clean energy?
Yeah, so we actually did, for those that are really familiar with the PSAP in Chapter 4, actually in the, I don't know, sorry, if you can look it up, but we actually do provide the carbon emissions, CO2 emissions from each of the plants considered. So we actually calculated the CO2 emissions from actually three different plants. We actually had what we call the post-April PSIP plan. You guys just like post-April PSIP plan. It's a mouthful, but really we kind of use it. We coined it because after we turned in our April PSIP, we realized that there was improvements that we could do to the plant. So what we did was basically continued on with the plant that did not have LNG. We also then, when we received the order from the commission to use a different analytical process, to use a computer model to actually develop the most optimal resource plans, we developed, and this was by a company called E3. So we have an E3 plan and an E3 plan with LNG. So we looked at three different plants and we actually calculated the CO2 emissions from each plant. Not surprisingly, the ones that maximizes the renewables earliest are the lowest CO2 emission plans overall. And actually for the particular case that if you look at it, actually the LNG plans were actually higher because it does burn fossil fuels through the period. So while I can't say that we placed a monetary value on it, we certainly did do the calculations and certainly did look at it. But you know, there's a whole bunch of multitude of factors looking at overall cost, things of what we felt we could do. So we did actually consider it, but in terms of trying to quantify the value, it doesn't work into the actual equation, if you will, in terms of selecting resources.
And then maybe with regards to Colony Power Plant, specifically all plants that we analyzed had the facility retiring in 2022.
The audience question is, will all houses and buildings, including businesses and schools, be required to run on PV solar energy panels, thus using 100% renewable energy for all electricity? Is that what 100% renewable mean?
No. Because the plan includes a diverse set of resources, both we call it distributed, so that means it's on a customer business, like a rooftop solar system. But you may have heard earlier that we're also looking at centralized systems to the extent that maybe a developer can get economies of scale to bring the prices down. So, and also looking at projects like, we call it community-based renewable energy projects, where it's maybe a centralized or large-scale PV farm, but that customers can maybe almost buy into the ownership of that PV farm. And it's kind of like a condominium concept where you divide it and you can get the benefit of having PV, but not have it on your rooftop. So it's really a combination of both rooftop or distributed systems on businesses and homes. And we have quite an aggressive forecast in the plans. So it's an option for customers like yourselves to make, or we're looking to bring down the price of renewable energy by contracting at a larger scale.
If I could add to that, I think just one challenge as you look at it by the customer, so the amount of solar generation, you saw the curve that actually Matt puts up, it kind of goes like a bell-shaped curve. So actually that doesn't necessarily match the customer loads very well. So really what that would mean for those particular customers to be self-sufficient, they would need to have sort of on-site energy storage. And all the customers are somewhat in different situations. So as the utility, what we try to do is ensure that we can provide service to all customers regardless of what their situation is. So while some may have the means to, for example, put PV panels, and some may have the means to put PV panels and batteries,
Some may choose to do batteries only because it's more advantageous to do a demand response program. We want to be able to service all the customers to meet their specific needs. And our vision for the future and how this plan works is to be able to leverage all of those resources together. And we talk about modernizing the grid is to be able to tap into all those resources and maximize the value of the services it can provide to the system so that we can cost effectively service all customers. So if you do things individually and everybody does their own thing, it's going to be a very expensive way to do things. So what we're envisioning going forward is to try to find a way to leverage all of the resources that are connected to the grid.
We have another audience question. So for Maui, by 2021, what percentage increase in solar and wind generation from current levels do you expect?
I'm trying to look at this chart.
60, right?
That was up on the slide deck, but there was very little grid scale solar. Yeah. There was continued increase of customer solar and that 60 megawatts of wind, roughly 60 megawatts of wind. Sorry, we don't have the percentages broken up.
Following up more audience questions, we've got two related ones here on batteries. Are specific measures being taken to research alternate battery storage options, specifically including flow batteries? And what specific organizations or funding is involved in research in Maui County?
I'm not aware of specific funding on Maui, but I know that our Hawaiian Electric team, we have a, they're not a research team, but a team that looks at new grid technologies for adoption in our service territories. But we work with national labs like Sandia and also National Renewable Energy Lab in Colorado to not duplicate the effort that they already are doing. But we certainly provide input in terms of the issues that we're dealing with. And I believe our engineers and Todd may know more about what they do, but they definitely are involved in working with the researchers there to leverage what already exists, right, in the nation to share information and see what kind of potential solutions we can adopt or test even in our service territory.
Okay. Is Maui Electric Company in trouble? Our audience is wonderful, right? You're very direct. How confident is Maui Electric that they will be able to retain a customer base? And how will Maui Electric deal with less customers anticipated in the future?
Well, I'm confident that we'll be here because what we'd like to do is work maybe in a different way with different projects that customers are looking at. So as you heard, it's not, customers want kind of the reliability of service. So although I think they may be able to generate a lot of their electricity to meet their usage, or their needs for electricity, they still want to be interconnected. And we certainly want them to because we want to retain them as a customer. What we want is to be able to, again, price it right so that the fixed cost to maintain the system aren't borne only by those who cannot afford to do that. We, as the public utility, have a very special obligation that we take seriously, and is that we have an obligation to serve all customers who would like electricity. So to the extent that we can work with you on different rates or finding different programs that might meet your need and still lower your electric bill or help to incent you to lower your usage in terms of efficient use of electricity, I think that's the type of dialogue we'd like to have with you. So it's not that the people who cannot afford to put rooftop PV or generate their own electricity are kind of left holding the cost for us to maintain the system. And that's why I think it's so important for us to work together and to get your input and feedback on, so is sooner better, but it might cost more, or is it taking a little more time? Seeing if the technology cost will certainly drop the way a lot of the manufacturers are telling us. So we want to continue this type of dialogue and work with you.
One piece of just information I think the audience deserves to know is there was a section of this plan that was redacted and not available to the public. And that section is an analysis of what they call the customer exit scenario. In other words, are people going to find that it's cost effective for them to leave the grid? So it's a topic of interest to a lot of people, and I just wanted to say that it is included in the version of this plan that the PUC will see. It is not included in the version that any of us in the public have seen.
That's interesting. I'm really glad that this question was asked by two different, it's actually the same person. I guess you really wanted to ask this question. Anyway, thank you for reminding me, because I had the same question at our last forum. Really, when you speak of the cost and the lowest cost, are you including all of the impacts to our planet from creation of these renewable energy, like creation of the panels, creation of the windmill blades, all of the energy that goes into producing those things? Are you considering those things? And then at the other end, well, in the middle, what about the transportation costs of getting those things here? And then at the end, what about the disposal of the batteries, of the solar panels? I've seen a lot of articles about wind systems that when the tax credits run out and the company folds, then you have these rusting hulks just swinging in the wind, so to speak. What kind of analysis have you done, and I would add, how does that relate to what was formerly called the integrated resource planning type of cost considerations?
So the costs that are actually considered when we speak costs is what we call total resource costs. So it's the actual capital cost to purchase that particular resource. Regardless of whoever it is, whether it be a developer, IPP, or whoever it may be, or a customer. So basically that's the cost that we that got modeled, and that's basically the cost that get evaluated when we talk about lowest cost. So to answer the question about the, you know, the impacts of producing the PV panels, or the impacts of producing, you know, windmill blades and generators, those sort of things, is certainly beyond what was considered. In terms of actual what happens to assets beyond, so for the one that's in particular that we do know has a finite amount of life is batteries. So what we did kind of contemplate is cost to actually renew those batteries every 15 years.